The COP28 Climate Summit in Dubai wraps up with nearly 200 countries signing a deal to transition away from fossil fuels. The summit's president called it a historic agreement, but not all nations are satisfied.
A deal in the desert that proponents say heralds the end of the age of oil. All 198 nations present at the COP28 climate summit in Dubai signed up to the final deal. For the first time, the agreement calls on all countries to transition away from fossil fuels, the main driver of climate change.
It is a plan that is led by the science. It is a balanced plan that tackles emissions, bridges the gap on adaptation, reimagines global finance, and delivers on loss and damage.
Many delegates welcomed the agreement after 2 weeks of hard-fought negotiations.
Everybody here should be pleased that in a world of Ukraine and the Middle East, war and all the other challenges of a planet that is foundering, this is a moment where multilateralism has actually come together and people have taken individual interests and attempted to define the common good.
More than 100 countries had lobbied for stronger language to fully phase out fossil fuels. But oil-producing states, led by Saudi Arabia, argued that the world can slash emissions without shunning specific fuels. That prompted criticism from some delegates, including the most vulnerable island nations.
We have made an incremental advancement over business as usual, when what we really needed is an exponential step change in our actions and support.
On the one hand, this is a good sign and signal that the world is finally dealing with fossil fuels after almost three decades of refusing to deal with it. But on the other hand, the new text includes cavernous loopholes that will allow for the oil and gas industry to continue.
That includes the use of so-called carbon capture technology, which removes some carbon dioxide emissions.
The energy transition to renewables is far more feasible than trying to capture carbon from the atmosphere. We know what we need to do, and governments now need to find ways that work for them economically and politically to commit to that and then deliver it. And that needs to happen very fast.
Scientists say we need to cut greenhouse gas emissions by 43% in just 6 years to meet the target of limiting global warming to 1.5 degrees Celsius above pre-industrial levels. It remains to be seen whether this COP28 deal marks a turning point or another missed opportunity. Henry Ridgewell, VOA News, London.
Over in the U.S., the Federal Reserve left interest rates unchanged in their final meeting for the year. Fed Chairman Jerome Powell also hinting the historic policy tightening cycle is likely over, with multiple rate cuts coming into view in 2024. While policymakers did not take rate hikes off the table, they said it's no longer the central bank's base case. Risks to inflation and employment also coming into better balance.
We can't know. We still have a ways to go. No one is declaring victory. That would be premature. And we can't be guaranteed of this progress. So we're moving carefully in making that assessment of whether we need to do more or not. That's really the question that we're on. But of course, the other question, the question of when will it become appropriate to begin dialing back the amount of policy restraint in place, that begins to come into view. And is clearly a topic of discussion out in the world, and also a discussion for us at our meeting today.
U.S. stocks jumped following the Fed's latest move, with the Dow closing at a record high. The son of U.S. President Joe Biden defying an order by House Republicans to testify behind closed doors about his business dealings. This as House lawmakers authorized their impeachment inquiry into the U.S. president with 221 and 212 party line vote. At a news conference outside the Capitol, Biden's son called the probe baseless, indicating he won't cooperate in the proceedings.
For 6 years, I have been the target of the unrelenting Trump attack machine shouting, "Where's Hunter?" Well, here's my answer. I am here. Let me state as clearly as I can, my father was not financially involved in my business, not as a practicing lawyer, not as a board member of Burisma, not in my partnership with a Chinese private businessman, not in my investments at home nor abroad, and certainly not as an artist. Republicans do not want an open process where Americans can see their tactics, expose their baseless inquiry, or hear what I have to say. What are they afraid of? I'm here. I'm ready.
Israel, suffering its worst one-day combat losses in more than 2 months of fighting with Hamas. 10 of its soldiers were killed in the past 24 hours, including two military leaders, after an ambush in the ruins of Gaza. Hamas says this showed Israeli forces could never subdue Gaza. But Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu remains firm, their war against Hamas will persist until victory is achieved. Israel has been facing growing pressure and criticisms as civilian deaths mount and a humanitarian catastrophe worsens in the Palestinian territory.
We are continuing until the end, until victory, until Hamas is annihilated. Let there be no doubt about this. I say this in the face of great pain, but also in the face of international pressures. Nothing will stop us. We will go to the end, to the victory, no less than that. Thank you. We do it because of you, through you, with God's help and with your help. Thank you so much.
The head of the United Nations Palestinian Refugee Agency decried Switzerland's move to cut aid for Gaza. This, as the agency says, the enclave is facing an apocalyptic humanitarian crisis. It adds the agency's capacity to do its work in Gaza is on the verge of collapse.
And despite our successes, UNRWA suffers from chronic underfunding, which impacts the quality of our services. Upholding refugees' rights is not only the responsibility of humanitarian and development actors, it is a responsibility shared with donors and host countries.
The Swiss National Council approved cutting an annual contribution of 20 million Swiss francs to the agency. But the Swiss upper house is set to assess the move Thursday. Both houses have to approve for the proposal before it can take effect.